What's up? Medite here. In this video, we're going to go through the anatomy of the esophagus. So in the last video, we went through the anatomy of the pharynx. Now the next step after the pharynx is the esophagus, as you see here. So in this video, we're first going to look at the parts of the esophagus. After that, look at the curvature and the constrictions of the esophagus. Then we're going to go through the layers of the esophageal wall through a histology slide. Cool. So let's start by looking at an anterior view of the esophagus. The esophagus lies between the pharynx and the stomach, as you see here. Now the length of the esophagus varies a lot, but in average it should be about 25 centimeters long. The pharynx is divided into three parts according to their anatomical location. First, we have the cervical part, which lies in the neck. Then we have the thoracic part, which lies in the thoracic cavity. And then we have the abdominal part, which lies in the abdominal cavity. So these are the three parts of the esophagus. Let's go through where each of these starts and ends. The cervical part starts at the pharynx. So remember, the pharynx has two openings. There's a laryngeal inlet, which leads into the larynx. And then there's a pharyngeal opening into the esophagus, or ostium pharyngeum, which is going to be the start of the cervical part of the esophagus. And the cervical part ends just before it enters the thoracic cavity through the superior thoracic aperture, or the upper opening of the ribcage. So the cervical part starts at the pharyngeal opening into the esophagus and ends at the superior thoracic aperture. After the cervical part is the thoracic part, and this one is going to start at the superior thoracic aperture and go all the way down until it pierces the diaphragm. And remember, the area at which the esophagus pierces the diaphragm is called the esophageal hiatus. So the thoracic part starts at the superior thoracic aperture and ends at the esophageal hiatus. After the thoracic part has gone through the diaphragm and it enters the abdominal cavity, it becomes the abdominal part, which is going to start at the esophageal hiatus and then is going to end at the cardinal orifice of the stomach. So that was all the three parts of the esophagus. Now, the esophagus goes vertically down at the midline, right? I mean, it's easy to imagine that the esophagus just goes down in a straight line, but it actually has some curvatures that's important anatomically. First is at the beginning. It curves slightly to the left, as you see here. Then in the middle of the thoracic part, it curves slightly to the right. And then at the lower thoracic region, it curves to the left again to then go through the diaphragm and then into the stomach. So that was the curvatures of the esophagus. Another thing we need to know about the esophagus is that it's going to have some constrictions. Depending on the tone of the constrictions, we can divide them into anatomical constrictors that are there by anatomical development. Therefore, they will continue to be there even when there is no life in the organism. And then we have something called physiological constrictors, which function only in a living body. And you will understand why in a minute. And here to navigate, we will add the vertebral column just to know at which level the different constrictions are located. First, we got the pharyngeoesophageal constrictor, which lies at the border between the pharynx and the esophagus, which is the opening into the esophagus of the pharynx. It's at the 6 to 7 cervical vertebrae. This one consists of skeletal muscles. And this is what I want you to think about also. You have different muscles along the different parts of the esophagus. The physiological constrictors are all smooth muscles, so you kind of get a sense of why they are called physiological constrictors. They are smooth muscles, so you're not in control of them, because they're controlled by the autonomic nervous system. And after the body has lost its function, the physiological constrictors are going to relax and disappear with it. Alright, so the pharyngeoesophageal constrictor is all skeletal muscles, and it closes off when breathing. Next, we have the bronchoaortic constriction, situated behind the left principal bronchus at the level of the 4th thoracic vertebrae. Then we have the phrenic constrictor, or the diaphragmatic constrictor. I want you to remember this word phrenic, because you're going to see this word a lot when you look at structures associated with the diaphragm. After all, phrenic is a general anatomical term used to describe structures related with the diaphragm. So the phrenic constrictor is at the esophageal hiatus at the level of the 10th thoracic vertebrae. So those are the anatomical constrictors. Now, let's look at the physiological constrictors. Remember, those are made of smooth muscles. The first physiological constriction is at the level of the 8th, 9th thoracic vertebrae. I had to add the aorta here to show you it better, because the physiological constriction is situated right where the esophagus crosses the aorta, as you see here. So the last constrictor is where the esophagus terminates into the stomach at the region of the 11th thoracic vertebrae. This one's also called the lower esophageal sphincter. So that was all the constrictions of the esophagus. The last thing we're going to look at in this video is taking a small section of the esophagus and look at the layers of the esophagus, as you see here. And just so you get the orientation right, remember the lumen is here. So this is the inner layer of the tube. The word lumen just means a hollow space inside a tube. So this side is the inner layer of the esophagus. All right. So the first layer of the esophagus is the tunica mucosa, which is a layer of stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium. And right under the epithelia, there are going to be the mucosal glands to lubricate the surface, as well as blood vessels and nerves and lymphoid nodules. We'll just call them vasculature. And it's all supported by a lamina muscularis mucosa, as you see here in red. Underneath the mucosal layer, we have tela submucosa. And keep that in mind that tunica means a layer of tissue, while tela means a web-like or loose connective tissue. So all the layers are tunica except for tela submucosa, because in this layer you will find loose connective tissue together with some esophageal glands which produce mucin for lubrication. And they also have glands called esophageal cardiac glands, which produce neutral mucin that protects the esophagus from the acidic gastric juice, because remember, the stomach contains hydrochloric acid, which might damage the tunica mucosa in the esophagus. So it's important to have something to neutralize the hydrochloric acid in case there are any conditions that causes you to vomit or reflux of gastric content. So that's the tela submucosa. Then after that, we have the tunica muscularis, which consists of two layers. The inner layer is a circular muscle layer, or circular muscle fibers, because they're arranged circularly, while the outer layer are longitudinal muscle fibers. And remember when I said about the different types of muscles along the different parts of the esophagus? The upper third of the esophagus is normally striated skeletal muscles, and then is gradually replaced by smooth muscle tissue. And then at the lower third of the esophagus, it's all smooth muscle. So that's this layer. The last layer is a protective outer layer, and it consists of either fibrous, tunica adventita, or serous, tunica serosa. In the cervical and thoracic region, the esophagus is covered by a thick connective tissue called tunica adventita. But the moment the esophagus goes through the diaphragm and becomes the abdominal part, it meets something called peritoneum, which we will talk about in a separate video. But the peritoneum is what protects the abdominal organs from external pressure, and it also forms a serous coat around the organs so that the organs can slide without friction. So what the peritoneum does is that it goes along and grabs the esophagus at the abdominal region and forms a serous coat called the tunica serosa. That's why only the abdominal part consists of tunica serosa around it, while the rest of the esophagus consists of tunica adventitia. So that was all I had for the anatomy of the esophagus. If you found this video helpful, please put a like, share, comment, whatever you found convenient to you. The next video in the digestive system is going to be about the stomach.